better. Tell us about where you were born and where you grew up.
Okay, I was actually born in Heena in Derbyshire, but at the age of 2 weeks, being brought from the nursing home, was brought up in a place called Eastwood in Nottinghamshire, which is famous for two things. The Midland Railway started there. The local colliery owners got together, and instead of sending their coal away to the south by canal, they decided it really was time to have a railway. This is way back in about 1836. And you can see in the Sun Inn, on the facade of the Sun Inn in Eastwood, the details of how the colliery owners met and decided they were going to have a railway. And the railway is still there. It's the main line from London to Sheffield. The other thing is, of course, that Eastwood is the birthplace of a very famous and once much maligned author called D.H. Lawrence. Who was brought up in the town. He became a teacher in the town, and then he went to University College in Nottingham, and then went to work in Croydon in South London, and eventually, you know the story, they say he eloped with Frieda Weekly, who was his French and German professor's wife, but in fact it was not quite that. So people say, oh, colliery, mines, dust, dirt, smuts, you know, the fine grain of coal dust everywhere. It was not a bit like that. It was an agricultural area, and the mines were hidden mainly by in the undulating countryside.
As a child, did you have any role models or screen idols?
Yes. When I was about 10 or 11, another boy and I in the class, we were both avid cinema goers. Eastwood had two cinemas, the Empire and the Rex. The Empire was put up in 1912, the Rex in 1938. And we started to collect film stars' photographs. And he apparently had more money, because he was an only child and his parents gave him more money. I was one of two, so my pocket money was limited, and we would write off, to Alan Ladd, "Dear Mr. Ladd, I have seen all your films, would you please send me a photograph?" And one came back, and often a signed letter. I've still got them, and an actress friend who does antiques says, "Well, you ought to sell them, because you can make a lot of money out of them," but I don't know. So, yes, people like Cornel Wilde. Who is Cornel Wilde, you're going to say? And people like that, and they were role models at the time, but you're only 10 or 11, and so you change.
Apart from acting, what other jobs have you done, and what is the best and worst of these?
Well, when I left school, I became a clerk. But when you're acting, of course, there are some bad times, and once a friend said, I can't do this job. It's a kind of toastmaster at a medieval banquet in Shropshire. Do you want to do it? You know, it was £50 cash in the hand, and the gas bill needed paying and all that sort of thing. So I said, okay, here's the script, he said, here's a tape of what you do. And I met the people for the first time in Hampstead, and about 4 o'clock in the afternoon, we drove to Shropshire. And they said, you do know what to do, don't you? Yes. Well, that was, I think, my worst job ever, because I was hopeless at it, and it's really something I'd like to eradicate from my memory. But I was glad of the £50, yes.
Can you remember the turning point in your life when you decided to become an actor?
Yes. The school was Eastwood was doing a pageant. I don't know whether it was Eastwood's celebration for, I can't remember what it was, but he was doing a pageant on the local park, and our English master was directing certain sequences, and I was the herald in the pageant. And we were doing rehearsals one day, and he said, "Have you ever thought of being an actor?" And from that moment, of course, you know, that was it. And so I went to a teacher in Nottingham, and then took auditions and got myself into RADA. Mm-hmm.
So RADA's where you did your training. Did mm-hmm. you graduate with anyone who is now quite
famous? Oh, indeed, yes. This is where Albert Finney, Peter O'Toole. I remember I was in my first year, and all the people in the first year were kind of slaves when it came to evening performances, because they had to help with the backstage stuff and putting the furniture on. And Peter O'Toole was playing in a Shaw play, I remember. This was way back, isn't it now? And He was getting rather stroppy with the director, I remember. But what it was about, I simply cannot tell you because it's so long ago.
Tell us about your first television, radio and theatre.
Good heavens. First theatre was marvellous because I finished at RADA on the Saturday evening. We were doing The Caucasian Chalk Circle by Brecht, and I'd already written to the West of England Theatre Company, who were based in Exmouth in Devon, saying, do you want any spear carriers, or I'm finishing at RADA on Saturday the 29th of July or something. And they wrote back and said, come. So I went. I finished at RADA on the Saturday evening about 11. We said goodbye. The next morning at about 8:30, I was on a train from Waterloo going to Exmouth. And then on the Monday morning I met the people, we rehearsed the first play I was in, which was called Worm's Eye View, an appropriate enough title for somebody starting in the theatre, isn't it, by Delafield. And then at lunchtime, we went home and had our lunch, and they said, come back at 2:30. I duly did, and got into this converted furniture van, which had bus seats at the front, and behind all the furniture, props, costumes were stored, and off we went, I think, to Honiton in Devon, to the Corn Exchange there, where they were doing the current play. Took the furniture and the stage stuff out, hauled it up onto the stage of the Corn Exchange, put it up, lit it, dressed the set. Somebody gave me a hammer and a nail and said, put these two, what do you call them, flats together. Of course, I had no idea at all, but it was a great start. And then I had the evening off because they were doing a play. But when it came to the opening of Worm's Eye View, we played that for a week in Exmouth, and then we were on the road. You would either do two nights. I remember it was very interesting because you were always given hospitality and stayed in some weird houses, some very old houses, you know, going back to 1500 and all that sort of thing. And people would make you very welcome and give you a meal. And then they'd say, oh, you're in the such and such room. But sometimes they gave you such a hard mattress, you never got any sleep. But there we are.
What about radio?
Oh, radio. My very first radio was for Children's Hour. You remember Children's Hour? It was actually, I think it was live, though I did a lot of live broadcasts when I first started. And I played some sort of senator or something. The memories of it were the cast, really. They were people who'd featured in British black and white films, you know, who were now older, and they all wore suits and came in with their copies of The Times and everything. And one had seen them in things like The Seventh Veil or in Eric Portman films and things like that, you know, and it was quite interesting because you'd stared at them on the screen and there they were, you were working with them. It was a tale of those times, you know, of ancient Byzantine or something, but about anything else I can tell you about it doesn't exist in the memory, I'm afraid.
What about television?
Television was interesting because that was live again. But then you see, one had trained to be a live actor on the stage, so doing it live didn't really hold any fears or terrors. This was an episode from the Civil War, Roundheads, Cavaliers, and I remember sitting at a desk and having a hat and doing all sorts of bows and things. It was very nice. And that went out again on Rediffusion on their Children's Hour one Friday, live. And that was how it started, I guess.
Your first Doctor Who role was as Maniac in The Ark alongside William Hartnell. What memories have you got of The Ark?
Well, the rehearsal room. I told you earlier about rehearsal rooms, a boys' club, wooden floor, stage at one end, tea bar at the other. And it was in the road that lies directly parallel with the north side of Shepherd's Bush Green. And at the end of rehearsal every day, you would come out about 5:30. And I was using a motorbike at the time because it was cheaper, you know. And there would be a crowd of boys, young boys, sort of from 8 to about 12. And they were waiting for one person, William Hartnell, Doctor Who. Hey, Doctor Who, you know, talk to us, something like this. They would shout anything at him to get a reaction. back. And you say, hello, boys, you know, how are you doing? And then get off in his car and that sort of thing. But that sticks in my memory because every day they were there waiting for him. The director, I think, was Michael Imerson. And I had worked with him before, I think. And so, because I think I'd done a Dr. Finlay. And I think he'd remembered me from that.
My appeal for reason in this matter is simple and direct. The doctor and his companions have not denied that they brought the fever among us. They say it was an accident, and I believe them. For the simple reason that if they were, in fact, agents of the Refusions, they could have achieved their objective in a much simpler way. One in which they would not have exposed themselves to this danger.
But the Refusions...
That's no argument.
Then I have another. The fever is here. We have no answer for it. And it might well be that they are the only ones who can cure it.
Our microbiologists may still find an answer.
Perhaps. But if we were to agree that the doctor and his friends could, what is the value in expelling them from the spaceship?
Any particular memories of William Hartnell?
Well, again, you know, I'd seen him as a villainous character in so many black and white British films that the transition didn't occur. You know, the man who had been on the screen was the man you were working with. It's strange. It was odd to be watching them 3 years or, well, 4 years previously, and then suddenly to be working with them on the television. He was very professional, very precise, and knew what he wanted to do, you know, and of course he'd been doing the role for some time, and so he knew what was good for his presentation of himself, so that shone through as well.
Then 2 years later it was Doctor Who again with Patrick Troughton, this time in Fury from the Deep. Any particular memories about the locations or costumes?
Costumes, yes. It was the height of the popularity of Carnaby Street. And one day the wardrobe lady said, tomorrow morning, 10 o'clock, I think it must have been before the rehearsal started, Carnaby Street. And so we all trooped down there. And we went into Lord John. I don't know if that rings any bells with you. And all these wonderful... They were in wool and silk and that sort of stuff. They were very expensive, but they wanted sort of futuristic looking things. I think that the designs were based on the West Coast Californian casual clothing, and the English designer had sort of sharpened them up and made them more sort of minimal, if you like. And so I got a silky, woolly, what do you call them, polo neck sweater. And trousers that, you know, drainpipe trousers, and boots, slip-on boots. Wonderful they were. I wish I'd have bought them, because sometimes you can buy the things you use in theatre or television. And they cost a fortune. The whole thing cost a fortune. And of course we went into this shop, and there was a jazz band playing from a soundtrack somewhere, you know. It was at the height of Carnaby Street. I mean, that's all disappeared now, but it was the real thing, I remember. The filming was very memorable. We went down in a coach to Margate, and we were put up at the Nayland Rock Hotel, which, as you know, straddles the promenade and the beach, shown to our rooms. Mine was overlooking the sea, and then it's dinner time. We all came down into the hall to go to dinner. Great shock. You couldn't get in unless you wore a tie. So, you know, revolution was about to start when suddenly the head waiter appeared with an armful of ties, and everybody, all the males got a tie, and so everybody got to eat. What else? On the beach, standing about in my Lord John stuff, but wrapped in a huge duffel coat because it was quite cold. It was fine, but it was very cold. And then I had a wonderful shot. They said, right, Roy, go right down there to the sea, which was miles away. And so I trudged down there. Now, on action, we want you to run like hell, because I think something had happened to my wife, hadn't she? All the stuff was coming out of the pipe. I don't remember. You know, just keep running. And they picked me up on a zoom and held it for some time. That was quite exhilarating. Then I remember the take when my wife was sort of taken over enchanted by the fury from the deep, and she had to walk into the sea. And so we saw her back, her silhouette, because the sun was coming that way, saw her silhouette walking down into the thing, and she was very brave. She went under, and then cut, and she was whisked out, put into the helicopter, and it flew her back to the hotel. My feeling was that they'd built a pipeline, hadn't they, on the beach? Yes, and I had to peer at the sea and sort of look worried and do things like that. But it was lovely. It was very enjoyable.
What about the notorious foam?
Oh, the foam really got to one that, later on in the serial, when we had to go to Ealing and do a day's filming. And I remember standing sort of almost shoulder high in it, reacting to the stuff, but I think I overreacted because that particular shot was never used in the transmission, and then had to wander around the corridors and open doors, and the thing rushed out at one and react again. But once again, I was overacting, so that wasn't put into the thing. And then the stuff started to get on one, you know, and I think they had to give me another white jacket because I was the scientific person. And so really one was quite glad when it had finished, you know, because you were up to the eyes in it, literally.
Any memories of Victor Madden?
Victor Madden, oh yes, again, I mean, like William Hartnell. Even Patrick Troughton, because one had seen Patrick Troughton. Do you remember the Olivia Hamlet in 1948? Well, Patrick Troughton played was it the player king or the first player in that? Some part, because I was looking in some old film books recently, and his name came up. I thought, oh my goodness, you know, they all again had been doing, you know, bits and things, and then he'd got his part. Victor Madden, very much died in the wool cockney. He lived in just at the edge of where London stops and the fields begin, and used to drive in every day, I think. And he had a tape recorder, which in 1968 was quite bulky, and on it he'd recorded his own lines with spaces for the lines of the other people, and he learnt his lines that way. He was very much the Victor Madden that he'd always been in the films, you know. I mean, you could quote, cite 50 films, couldn't you, that he'd been in. I mean, they were so well known because they always gave you that same persona in the films. I think one thing about the rehearsal room was that there was a tabletop football thing, you know, that you would do with your hands. And that was very popular, I think, with Victor Madden and John Abineri. Again, I'm quoting from memory of 40 years ago, so I may be wrong, but some of the people really enjoyed using it, I remember.
Margot
Hayhoe? Margot Hayhoe, yes, a lovely lady, short. Quite small. I'd worked with on several televisions before, so it was lovely to work with somebody else work with her again, in fact, on Doctor Who. She was very calm, very easy. Like Hugh David was so calm about everything. Never got ruffled or anything. Margot now, I think, is quite high up in the TV hierarchy. Hierarchy, let's get the word right.
And one person who's got a bit of a reputation from Fury from the Deep is the helicopter pilot.
Yeah.
Memories of him.
Well, if it's right, and I mean, it was the helicopter pilot. It was one evening in the bar, after a day's filming, waiting to go in to eat, when this chap was drinking. There was a small group of us at the bar standing chatting. And he finished his drink. I think it was, I remember orange was in it, so perhaps gin was in it as well, I don't know. Or let's face it, he may have been a teetotaler. He finished his drink, said something, finished his drink, and then got hold of his glass and had quite powerful hands and crushed it. It was, a ball glass. And everybody turned and looked. And the next moment, his hands were going to his mouth, and all these pieces of glass were going into his mouth, which he promptly chewed and then swallowed. And the bar just came to a standstill, you know. Anyway, conversation gradually resumed, and then somebody, he either bought himself another drink or somebody bought him another drink, and the same thing happened. And, well, it was just amazing. I'd never seen anybody do that before. That you thought, well, what happens? I mean, he must have an iron inside or something, because it could cut into your bowels and everything, couldn't it? You know, but there we are.
If there had ever been a sequel to either The Ark or Fury from the Deep, would you have returned to the roles of Maniac from The Ark or Harris from Fury?
Yes, indeed. I mean, you know, as a jobbing actor, where you very often take what comes up. I mean, it's not very often that I've refused things. I have on certain occasions, but certainly yes, because it was such a happy time doing them and working with such good people and being able to watch people like Hartnell and Troughton particularly. So yes, gladly I would have taken them up again.
Having worked with Hartnell and Troughton, did you ever meet or work with any of the other actors who have played Doctor Who?
No, never, no. I've got a feeling I was in a broadcast once where Tom Baker was there, but again, that may be just a memory that floats into the memory box but isn't a true one.
Did you ever consider taking, or were you ever offered any other parts in Doctor Who?
Yes, I once auditioned for the dog in Doctor Who and didn't get it, I'm afraid. It went to a friend, David Brierley, didn't it? Yes, David Brierley.
Mm. Have you got a piece of theatre work that you are particularly proud of?
Yes, this was at Billingham in... Is it Northumberland or Cumbria? No, it's near Newcastle, isn't it? So it doesn't matter. Well, they just built there a great complex of indoor swimming pools, bowling greens, tennis courts, but they'd also built a very good theatre as part of the building. And a man called George Roman I went to audition for, and he said, well, come along and play these parts. And I did Macduff in the Scottish play, whose name cannot be mentioned, and then played in St. Joan, and then in a play by Harold Pinter, whose title I cannot think of, but I played the part of Stanley, who had been, or so he said, a concert pianist. And then these men, Goldberg and somebody else, arrive and browbeat him, and it was all sort of angst and very heavy acting, and we really slogged at it, and afterwards you felt, well, yes, you know, you got there, you achieved it, and you held on to it, and it was a very good lesson. So I enjoyed that very much. One or two other things that at Leicester once we did a Chekhov. Oh, the one where the man shoots himself, the cherry orchard, and I played a doctor in that. And again, because it was thrust theatre and the audience were on top of you, you had to develop a very televisual style of stage acting. And that, again, I thought, well, yes, that was quite good. Sometimes you reward yourself with a tick, you know.
Similar question, is there a piece of television acting work that you're proud of?
Well, yes, I think the thing I mentioned, the three-part serial about the abolition of the slave trade, when I had to age from 22 to about 85, and afterwards looking at that, I thought, very good, very good.
Mm. When would that have been?
Oh, goodness, that was in the 70s sometimes, I think. Yeah. Another thing was, in a thing called Bomber Harris. John Thor played Harris, you know, who was in charge of Bomber Command, and it was all about the controversy when we kept bombing Dresden, and that was a big production. We were on it for 6 weeks, I remember, and I played a man called Magnus Spence, of all names, and he was the meteorologist, and so I was in there. I was the only person in a cast of probably 50 in civilian clothes, while the rest were in Air Force uniforms. And looking at that afterwards, yes. Mm. You could see the rehearsal showed it, because we were living the parts.
The prospects for both landings and target areas are mixed. Over northern Germany, there is much thundery cloud, and some breaks in the northwest, decreasing southwards and dispersing gradually in
the Middle Rhineland. With regard to home bases, returning crews in all group areas can expect convection cloud decreasing with some thundery showers.
Any chance of a full moon over the target areas?
I may be able to answer that in a later forecast, due any minute, sir.
Thank you, Spence.
Sir. There's been no rain for a fortnight, sir. The weather will remain hot and dry for at least 24 hours. Vegetation and timber buildings will be like tinder. Temperatures in the Hamburg area will be in the 80s.
Operation Gomorrah. Hamburg. Tonight. Let's burn it.
Have you ever encountered the film world at all?
Yes, only tiny bits. The thing I was telling you about, not Frankenstein, the other man. Dracula, yes. The famous American actor played it, and I was a hotel clerk, and that was a very good example of where you've learned your lines, but then when you get to the set, the director says, "Oh, we've changed it slightly. Say, would you call for the horses, please, at the door before you speak, and when you finish, say, well, take the luggage out, my man, or something like that." And there's a person, you know, the camera, the focus puller, is it, has got the tape up to your chin, and somebody's dusting your face, and several other voices, and you're thinking, will I remember these lines? And then action, and you have happily remembered them. But again, that's all part of being an actor. I sold a horse to Ryan O'Neill in Stanley Kubrick's, here we go, Memory Lane again, Barry Lyndon. That was wonderful, because working with Stanley Kubrick was wonderful, because I was first cast as a doctor, but with a Stanley Kubrick's film, the script developed as the film was shot. So they rang up and said, "No, I actually had a costume fitting and went to somewhere in Wiltshire and sat in a hotel for 2 days waiting for the call." But they said, "No, the doctor's out. Go back home." Then they rang up again. "Stanley wants you. He wants you to be a hairdresser." Another costume fitting. Go to another hotel somewhere in... It was all filmed around Salisbury at the time. Oh, no, sorry. I'm getting it wrong. We went to Ireland first. I was a captain in the army first. This is when the sequence came up where I had to speak German. At 2 o'clock they said, "Can you speak German?" "No. Here's the script. Learn it. Go away and learn it." And at 3:30, I was riding up on a horse and talking to this woman in German. And they bought the final take anyway, so... But that's being an actor. No, so we went to Ireland, and that was abortive because Stanley decided that he didn't want the scene with the captain. We came back to England, and I was a doctor. They didn't... I did actually get on set, and there was... Ryan O'Neill and Marisa Berenson, is it, who played in it. I think she played his daughter. And I had to attend to her and say things. And Stanley said, "No, don't like that. Go home." Then another white Volvo appeared at the front door, and I was whisked off to Wiltshire. And this time I was a hairdresser. And that didn't work. Again, I got into a room in one of the big country houses near, not Salisbury, there's another place near Salisbury, but it doesn't matter. And so they said, "Go home." And then finally, I was a salesman. I was a horse breeder, and I sold this horse to Ryan O'Neill, and that was filmed. And that appears in the film.
75 seems more like the right price.
I'll accept 80 guineas and not a shilling less.
5 guineas should never keep 2 gentlemen from their drink. 80 it'll be.
Done, sir.
Timmy, you take the horse over to Doolan's farm and tell him he needs a bit of breaking in. And say it's for Master Brian's birthday next week and I want it to be a surprise. And remember that yourself.
Yes, sir.
Can you remember where you were when you heard the news of Kennedy being assassinated?
Yes, in London, NW6. In a friend's flat. I'd been at Pitlochry, and that had finished, and I had nowhere to live, and I'd known this chap, at Stratford, and he shared a flat with some other university friends, and he said, well, we've got a spare room, take it for the while. And so I took it, and we were listening to the radio, I think. But the interesting thing about that is that Kennedy was assassinated, but almost on the same day, a writer named Aldous Huxley died, whom I've got to know through knowing things about Lawrence. But, you know, the tide of history swept over it, and poor old Aldous just got steamrolled into obscurity, I think, didn't he?
Have you currently got any hobbies?
Yes, I collect first editions of D.H. Lawrence. Mm-hmm. Which started years ago, and I now in touch with friends in America, and so we write letters and gradually, you know, collect the books, I guess. It's a crazy, but I mean, you're interested in Doctor Who. Lawrence for me. I don't go for Lawrence's letters and things like that, or a check book that belonged to Lawrence or anything like that. I just like to have the books as they were published, you know, in decent, clean condition.
Is that a difficult hobby to pursue?
It is these days, because money has, corporate money. People, when the stock market failed, people said, well, what can we put our money into? Silver, furniture, property. Then the property market began to sag. And now it's gone into... I mean, once upon a time, you could buy a first edition of Lady Chatterley's Lover for $600. I was offered a copy of Lady Chatterley's Lover in Santa Barbara in California in 1979. And the last copy, well, it went for sale at Sotheby's, went for £11,000. So I still don't have one. If you see a spare one at a jumble sale, please remember me.
Have you any unfulfilled ambitions?
Well, yes, I suppose I'd like to see my name in print again, and I would really like to sort of, say, be in a TV serial again. That would be nice, you know. One's done the work, got the experience. That doesn't, it's like swimming, it doesn't disappear. So I'm harbouring it, ready for when the book's finished and I can get back to these things. It would be nice.
Tell us why you think Doctor Who has such an appeal and a strong following after over 40 years.
Good question. Like on that mastermind, I think I ought to say pass, really. I don't know. It's astounding. It's astounding that it should happen. That people who were born after it had been, the final transmission had gone out, should, I think it's something to do with the eternal, it's a kind of, it's a boyhood thing, isn't it? It's a bit about magic or something like that, of the magical figure, the Merlin figure. There's always a helpful, paternal figure who's got magical powers, but whose heart is in the right place, who plays it by the rules, who is in for fairness and that sort of thing. And good behaviour. I think it's something to do with that. It's an elemental, eternal ingredient, I think, in Doctor Who.
I think on that note, Roy Spencer, thank you very much for your time.
Thank you very much indeed. It's been very nice talking to you.